Good morning, and welcome to St. Mark's United Church of Christ here on a rainy Sunday in New Albany, Indiana. So glad the rain hit today and not so much as of yesterday during our parade. Before we begin our time of worship, we have a few announcements. That's if you want to say few, we have quite a bit of announcements. This morning, the rose on the altar, as you can see, beautiful red rose, is announced the birth of Amelia Marie Harper, daughter of Abigail Asher and Peyton Harper. Amelia was born on September the 18th, 2021. Grandparents are Angela Rieckhoff and the late Jeremy Asher. I'm sorry if I butchered that. Jim Harper and the late Brenda Hollins Harper. Great-grandparents are David and Nancy Rieckhoff and Taffy Asher and Patrick Moore. Great-great-grandparents of Belton and Helen Asher. The youth group, before I turn things over to the announcements that we have, the youth group wants to thank all for, we up, we better? Okay. Want to thank everyone for coming out and supporting our youth group. Yesterday during our Harvest Homecoming Parade concession sales, we had a wonderful crew and a lot of help from adults as well, so thank you for the adults that assisted us. We raised just a little over $704 was purchased. Well, then when we take out our expenses, we actually had a profit of $445. So thank you all. It was still a wonderful turnout. And since we have so many announcements, I'm now going to turn it over to whichever one would like to step up first. Pat, would you want to go first? There you go.
I am here this morning to represent a group of very intelligent, fun-loving, creative, did I say brilliant, women who have been working all year long to get ready for the Christmas shop. And this is our grand opening today for all of you. Now, I've been doing a little bit of calculating as I was coming to church this morning, and judging on the numbers that are here, and I don't have the exact count up yet, but we will soon. If each of you were to buy about 30 items, we could probably get rid of this stuff this year. Very seriously, you have been so generous in giving us your tired and worn out Christmas decor. We fixed it up. You may not even recognize it. You may buy back something that you wanted to get rid of, and that's okay. Just know that even if you spend a dollar, every dollar you spend is going to support the mission of St. Mark's. Thank you so much. Oh, and I have cookies too.
Well, hello. I decided not to wear a black top so I wouldn't be confused with clergy. Nor have I ever been. But the reason that I'm here is because 1 week from today, actually at 5 o'clock next Sunday, is when Harvest Homecoming will officially be over, and that is when the food booth will be closing. With the closing of the food booth, there is very apt to be some leftover frozen boxes of food products, simply because we cannot guesstimate exactly how much we will need during the course of a four-day show. So we are limited in freezer space here at the church, and I am interested in anyone who can help with some temporary storage. Now, the largest box is this size. It's a 10-pound box. The next smaller is 6-pound boxes. But if you have a freezer chest or a shelf with some freezer space, this would be a temporary fix for us, simply to get it there for a while until we could see about using it either in our food pantry or give it to the seminary's pantry or have some other use for it. But between now and then, I'm going to need someplace for some frozen goods. At the end of this church service, I'll be at the back of the church, and if you can think of some freezer space, please let me know so that we have a place to put this instead of just having to throw away good food items, okay? The only other thing that I would like to say is that we are going to be doing the booth raising, that means the construction of our booth, on Wednesday at 6 o'clock, and all volunteers are welcome and no experience is necessary, okay? Thank you.
Good morning. So Pat talked about the beginning of Harvest Homecoming, and Reed talked about the end. I'm going to talk about the middle and the work that has to happen while Harvest Homecoming is going on. We have some critical volunteer spots available that need volunteers to make sure that the booth can run and the parking lot can take cars. And the flea market as well can operate the way that it knocked it out of the park this past weekend. If you are interested in doing that, if you have some time available, please see me or Kim in the back after church, or if you still have the Sign Up Genius link, you can use that Sign Up Genius link to fill out the time that you can work. We appreciate you and thank you. We couldn't do it without you. Thanks.
Thank you. Again, sign up after worship. Let us now welcome each other to our service. No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcomed here. God is still speaking. Let us now settle and set our heart and minds for our morning prelude.
Thank you.
Thank you, Nick and Sarah. That was beautiful. I would like to point out, if I may, I failed to do so during the announcements, but today is World Communion Sunday, as well as our Stewardship Sunday here at St. Mark's. And I want to give kudos and praise to the elders for this beautiful, beautiful communion table for us this morning. Let us now call each other to worship. We are created in relationship and for relationship. We are created for community. God knew it was right not for us to be alone. We are created for community. Through Jesus Christ, God entered into human relationship with us. We are created for community. We rejoice in our unity with all humanity. We are created for community. Let us rise either in body or in spirit for our opening hymn, hymn number 97, Fairest Lord Jesus.
May be seated. Let us now find our prayer of confession. Let us pray together. God made flesh, bone of our bone. We confess that we think we can go it alone, that we try to do it all, that in doing so we neglect the gifts you have given us, the bone of our bone, the flesh of our flesh, the bodies you created, and the relationships you created for us. Jesus Christ, you who lived in a human body, call us to community. Remind us that in you we are one. Awake in us a respect for one another and celebrate with us the diversity within that unity. May it be so now and forever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, hear now our assurance of pardon. You are the divine creation, and it is not right for you to be alone. Know now that you are forgiven and called back into relationship with God and with one another. Amen. Let us sing together. Brothers and sisters, respecting one another's space still in this time of pandemic, let us rise as you are able and pass the beautiful peace of Christ with one another. Peace.
At this time, I would like to invite any of the little ones that we have with us for our time of children in the pews to come forward with your mask on, and for those of you at home to gather around your devices, and for the young at heart seated to be attuned as well. Good morning. All right. Hey, we're just a small bunch this morning. That's okay. Ooh. Mr. Ken's going to try to sit down real gently. Okay. Standing on concrete all day yesterday was a little rough. But we are in the presence of a medal holder, aren't we? Right, Roy came in, had a medal. It was awesome. We got to see him finish along with his cousins. It was a lot of fun. Was that heavy? Well, I need the two of you to help me, and those of you in the pews can help along as well. I have got some neat items in my bag of wonders this morning, and you got to let me know what they are, okay? And maybe we can figure out what they're tied to. Let's see. I have, what is this? A clock, right? What do we do with clocks? They tell time. There we go. See, grown-ups, we don't need your help. All right, let's see. And, okay, well, this isn't much of an artwork, but this was supposed to be my painting. It's supposed to be a summer day. Not all that great of artwork, is it? See, folks at home and grown-ups. But this could be considered, if it was really immaculate and wonderful, it could be a talent, couldn't it? Yeah, like a talent of art, of drawing. I don't quite have that talent. Okay. Only stick figures. And then I have, what is it? Money. Everybody loves money, right? Uh-huh. And I have here, too, a piece of cardboard, little paper poster board that all of us grown-ups had to get today for church. And it's our pledge. What's all of this got to do together? We have time, talent, and treasure, right? And a card. We in the church use big words sometimes, and we call something called stewardship. Stewardship is when we make a commitment to use our resources for building up God's kingdom and serving God's people. And today, we are going, as grown-ups, are going to come forward and drop off our cards in our commitment sheet saying what our time, talent, and treasure that we're going to give to God's church. And each of you, even though you don't make all that money yet because you don't have a job, but you do win medals,
you still can also participate by giving of your time and your talent. And if you get a little bit of money on your birthday or whatever, you want to drop a quarter, you can do that as well. But being here in church and serving, and I know that before COVID, we did Thanksgiving baskets, didn't we? Then we put the Thanksgiving baskets together. That is how you also give during stewardship. Pretty cool? All right, let's pray. God, we thank you for allowing us to be here and for us to be able to give back to your church. Be with us, we pray in your name. Amen. And I'm going to ask the two of you to stay here with me, and we are going to have the deacons come forward and get situated, and we are going to invite the rest of the grown-ups to come up during our time of stewardship, to come out into the center aisle and drop off your commitment cards or time and talent sheets, and then go back to your pews on the side aisle and receive a gift. And you may come forward. See, it's pretty neat, ain't it? Well, once we get started. Grown-ups don't move as quickly as you do on races. Yeah. You are a speed demon. Oh, where's the place? Oh. Oh, there's the baskets. Yeah, thank you. There we go. And logistics difficulties sometimes happen in church too. There we go. Oh. Yeah, you want to. All collection plates are coming. We good? All right. Wasn't that awesome to see? And you know, we have many others that are at home, and if you were not able to be here in person, I do believe you can mail those into the church, your pledge cards and your time and talent sheets. And we got a packet of seeds. And I know my children's time is just wrapping up, but I'm going to finish with, it's neat to have seeds, because our theme for our stewardship and for our denomination was rooted in love. And we're going to plant these little flowers, and they're going to root just like each of us do here at St. Mark's. And we're going to grow in love. You can go now sit with your parents.
Good morning. The first part of our scripture today comes from Mark 10, 2 to 16. Some Pharisees came, and to test him, they asked, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" He answered them, "What did Moses command you?" They said, "Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of dismissal and to divorce her." But Jesus said to them, "Because of your hardness of heart, he wrote this commandment for you. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate." Then in the house, the disciples asked him again about this matter. He said to them, "Whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery." People were bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them, and the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, "Let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them.
Blessing which we bless. grain for the fields, scattered and grown, gathered to one for all, one bread, one body, one Lord of all, one cup of blessing which we bless, and we, though many, throughout the earth, we are one body in this one.
Thank you, Michael, and thank you for willingly stepping into the role as interim minister of music. We are blessed by your gifts. Now our scripture from Genesis this morning. God said, "It is not good for the man to be alone. I'll make him a helper, a companion." So God formed from the dirt of the ground all the animals of the field and all the birds of the air. He brought them to the man to see what he would name them. Whatever the man called each living creature, that was its name. The man named the cattle, named the birds of the air, named the wild animals, but he didn't find a suitable companion. God put the man into a deep sleep. As he slept, he removed one of his ribs and replaced it with flesh. God then used the rib that he had taken from the man to make woman and presented her to the man. The man said, "Finally, bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh, name her woman, for she was made from man." Therefore, a man leaves his father and mother and embraces his wife. They become one flesh. The two of them, the man and his wife, were naked, but they felt no shame. May God add understanding to our reading and our hearing of his holy word this day. We have a lot of different elements this morning in worship, and I'm going to try and tie them all together, and I appreciate your patience. But I want to begin with an old story. I suspect many of you have heard it. It's a European folk tale lost back in the mist of time. But it's about a fellow who was coming into a small village that was kind of renowned for being closed off to strangers. And this fellow was coming into town, and he was a stranger, and he was hungry. And as he came into town, he came to the first few doors, and he knocked, and people might answer from behind the door. They might open the door just a crack and ask what he wanted. What he wanted was to share a meal, and they would simply close their door or not respond. So it didn't take very long for this fellow to realize that he was not going to have much success going door to door. And so out of his possessions, he pulled out a pot. And he went down to the river that ran through the village, and he found a few good-sized rocks, and he cleaned them off, and he put them in this pot, and he filled the pot with water, and he built a little fire, and he put the pot on the fire. Well, one fellow in that village couldn't take it anymore. Curiosity got the best of him. And he came out and he says, "What you doing?" And the fellow stirred the pot a little bit and he looked up and he said, "Oh, I'm just making stone soup." "What's that? I never heard of that." "Oh, it's real good, stone soup. You bet, real good. But you know what makes it a little bit better? As if maybe we had a potato or two in there." Well, the neighbor said, "Well, shoot, I got one of those. I'll bring that on out and throw that in." "Okay." So he brought out the potato and they put that in. Wasn't too much longer, they're stirring the soup and somebody else comes out and says, "What you doing?" "Making stone soup." "You know, it would make it just a little bit better as if we had some onion." Well, shoot, I got some of those. I'll bring those on. So out they come, and one after another, the onion, the carrot, the potatoes, all manner of vegetables and things go into this pot. Well, pretty soon this pot begins to smell pretty good, and that gets the rest of the villagers out there, right? What you making? And it doesn't take any time at all before this bowl that was full of nothing but rocks and water is in fact now filled with a wonderful stew. And so after it's had time to cook just so and be seasoned just right, the last thing the stranger does, he pulls out those stones at the bottom of the pot and he serves everybody lunch. Stone soup. If there's a more apt metaphor for stewardship, I don't know what it is. Each one of us, in our own reticence to try and blend into the wallpaper, each one of us wants to stand back and say, no, I don't have any gifts. I don't have anything to share. But our curiosity and the smell of that soup slowly draws us out. And then we come forward like we did today with those cards, and we own up to the fact that, yes, indeed, we have got a few talents. We've got a few vegetables that we can add to the pot as well. What I want to remind you is, as we put all these things together, I want to remind you that God doesn't care about the size of our congregation. God does not find us more worthy because of the size of our pipe organ, or find us less worthy if we're just a storefront congregation led by somebody with a guitar. God instead sees us as people using the gifts that we have been given. That is the nature of stewardship. Then we have this story from Genesis. We don't do this creation story very often. For some reason, we tend to stick with the 7 days. There's two creation stories, you remember, one in chapter 1 and one in chapter 2. We tend to stick with the first one more often. I suspect we don't use this one as much because oftentimes this story is used as an excuse for how to make women slightly less than. That women were created in a way to serve man or to somehow be less than. But what I hope that you hear out of the story today, especially the translation that we used, is that God meant for the creation of woman so that we are not alone. Because we as human beings are not designed to be alone. God created community for us. We are meant to live in community with each other. Best example I can think of this is at Merom. I've told you, I suppose, a few times before that I tend to work with the younger kids, the elementary school age kids. And so the first time that they can come, they have just graduated from second grade and they're going into third grade. And so oftentimes they haven't spent a night away from home. And so now they've been driven way out in the wilds of southern Indiana, and their parents are waving goodbye, and the poor kid is just standing there being abandoned. You know, that's how they feel in that moment. And so there is always more than one crying child on the first day of camp. And we do our best to immediately get engaged and find activities and things to keep them busy. But more often than not, it's those same kids, the ones that are just going into third grade all the way up to the ones who graduated from high school, that are crying their eyes out on Saturday when it's time to leave. When was the last time anybody cried when it was time to leave church? This is something that we should aim for. But they have an experience there during that week. Not every kid, we can't promise it to every child. But more often than not, we find children have an experience there at camp with each other and with the counselors and with the worship services and the games that we play and the meals that we have and the times that we pray and the friendships that they have that they find something new that they don't have in the rest of their life. It's a different kind of community. And I remember that feeling too when I was a youngster and I would go off to church camp and I wondered, how could this 1 week a year, why can't we live that way the other 51? And I suppose that I was one of the kids that cried when I got abandoned at camp, and I was one of the kids that cried when it was time to go home. And so God created us for community. I want to remind you also that God created communion. Communion is a part of God's creation. Today, you'll notice the altar is decorated, and when you are here in the space, you see that all the window wells have been filled with wine and bread. We are gathered together today to celebrate World Communion Sunday. World Communion Sunday simply means that this is the one day set aside by so much of the Christian community, and I mean the large Christian community, to celebrate communion with one another. We have invented over 2,000 years more ways to disagree with one another, to be splintered, to be broken apart, to say that's heresy or you're wrong or you're doing it all bad. We have found more ways to disagree with one another than we have to agree, and none other more than communion. But on this Sunday, hundreds of millions of Christians will partake in communion together. And we will use millions of different words to describe what it is that we're doing. But the one thing we will all have in common is that we will all share this meal. We will share this meal, Christians, in all times and places, all colors, all creeds, every class there is, we shall share this one holy meal. And I pray that when we do that, we recognize in ourselves our own brokenness, our own lost spirits, the ways that we fall short. Because when we can understand ourselves to be broken, when we can understand that our shell is not complete, then we have the humility to look around at the rest of the world and to see our brothers and our sisters who are partaking of that same bread and that same cup with us. And then maybe we get a little sense of that thin space that kids seem to understand so much better than we do. That thin space that reminds us that we are close to God, our Creator. So, brothers and sisters, today we celebrate stewardship and we recognize our gifts. We celebrate community. The community that is here in this space, the sacred ground that we occupy together. The community that watches us on social media, that participates each and every week. But also the larger community of God's creation. And we celebrate communion with one another. Because when it really comes down to it, the best way that we see our brothers and our sisters is when we eat with them. So I leave you with these final two thoughts. Even as we bring our gifts forward today, we are receiving God's gifts. It's a simple thing to look at that time and talent sheet, but it forces each one of us to ask, what are our talents? What are we willing to give? And how do we use our time? And finally, be reminded that you were created for community and that you have gifts to share. Amen.
Weave us together, weave us together.
Take a moment as we gather ourselves for prayer. Loving and merciful God, we gather here in this space, sometimes with the simple hope of being here, feeling closer to you than anywhere else in our lives, that maybe here you hear these prayers that we lift to you. Maybe we find ourselves unable to find the words or the thoughts or the ways to pray in our life outside these walls. Gracious God, remind us that there is no right way to pray. There is only offering to you. We especially lift up to you today those who are suffering with family members who've been hospitalized, those who have continuing diagnoses, and those who grieve for the loss of loved ones taken too soon. We continue to look outside our walls and inside our walls and see the effects of COVID. We pray for an end that seems to never come. And we give you thanks for the ability to come back together this day in this space and this week as we welcome so many through our doors and into our community. It's no small thing, Lord, to ask for a little patience and grace when dealing with our brothers and our sisters. So for all of these things, this mixed bag of prayers, of joys, of concerns, of thanksgivings, of griefs, for all of these things, we ask that you hear our prayer this day. And now, dear God, hear these prayers that we raise to you, these things known only to you and to us. Dear God, we trust that you hear all of these prayers. Now hear us as we pray in one voice the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Dear Lord, As Pastor John has suggested, our efforts at stewardship are much like making stone soup. No single one of us can do it ourselves. We, by ourselves, simply do not have all the ingredients. But just as each of us has our own recipe, yet we come together on this World Communion Day to celebrate the stewardship that comes from cooking our soup together and then enjoying the fruits of our labor in your name. Amen.
Be seated. I want to invite you just to take a moment and get started. If you have any trouble, please raise your hand and someone would be happy to help get that cellophane started. Thank you.
And then by any chance that you did not receive a communion pack when you came in, please raise your hand and the ushers will get one to you.
You start.
There you go. First, God created one person.
But it was not right for that one person to be alone. That person had God, but needed an equal, so God made animals.
How about a giraffe, a raven, a dog? But it still wasn't enough. So God made another person, an equal, someone to share with and talk with. God created relationship. God created communion.
This at last is bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. And then God took it one step further. God looked at the many people living in relationship with one another and decided to join the community. God came to be with us as one of us, and his human family called him Jesus.
This at last is bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. And one night, when Jesus sat with his community, he took bread and broke it and blessed it, saying, "This is my body." He then took the cup, saying, "This is my body, blood." This at last is bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh.
Come, Holy Spirit, and make us one body of Christ.
This at last is bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. Bone of our bone, flesh of our flesh, one with each other and all humanity, the body of Christ. We invite you to share in the bread and the cup together, saying to one another, bone of our bone, flesh of our flesh, the body of Christ.
Take and eat, body of Christ. Take and drink the cup of salvation. Brothers and sisters, please join in our prayer of thanksgiving. We share this bread and cup with Christians in all times and places, equal in God's sight. We gather together, near and far, to celebrate our oneness. Thank you for the gift of this meal. May it feed our spirits, even as it nourishes our bodies. In sharing this sacrament, we are reminded that we are one in God's creation, bone of our bone and flesh of our flesh. Amen.
Let's stand as you are able and join in our closing hymn, Rise Up, O Saints of God. You, if you would, for a few minutes there, take your seats again. As you hear the benediction and we sing together our benediction response, not that the postlude isn't always wonderful, but you have Nick accompanying Sarah today, and I hope that we can take a few minutes and just hear the beautiful music that's been provided to us today. As you leave this sacred space, live out your connection with one another, knowing that all humanity is bone of our bone, flesh of our flesh, one world communion.
Amen. Amen.
The sun shines.